focus now on tō tātou anamata, our future. And I have a question for all of our panellists. Arama, I will start with you. Who should we let into New Zealand?
Well, one interesting statistic is that despite recent increases in immigration, our numbers from the Pacific have actually been decreasing. And, you know, our relations across the Pacific, they're part of the same culture. It was quite arbitrary that, you know, a circle was drawn around these three islands and this separation was created. We've been in this part of the world for 4,000 years, so what I would like to see is a recognition of that and more migrants from the Pacific.
Minister Farfoy, who should we let into New Zealand?
I think anyone who, or people who enrich our well-being, both economically and also culturally. And from my personal experience, we've actually got a history of doing that. I think we need to be more deliberate about it.
Paul Spoonley, who should we let into New Zealand?
People who want to come here and people who can contribute, and I mean contribute in the widest possible sense. So I agree with the Minister. Yes, we've got a set of economic interests that we want to see met, but remember that migration's also about social and cultural factors as well.
Oscar Kightley, who should we let into New Zealand?
Well, we kick people out when they fail character tests, and I feel like that should be at the heart of why we let people in. It should be about their character, what they bring, and I totally agree, more Pacific people. We tend to think New Zealand, that the Pacific is in New Zealand. It's not. New Zealand's in the Pacific, and we're acting like it's over there, next to Europe and, you know, wherever.
Arthur, who should we let into New Zealand?
Well, I agree with Meng Foon that people who come here should have an acceptance and willingness to work with the treaty and respect our human rights. I think that's very important. And then given that, I think the people that can and are willing to contribute to making New Zealand a better place.
Paul, let's pick up on that Tiriti point. What might a Tiriti-led immigration policy in the future look like?
Well, I think the involvement of Te Iwi Māori is critically important. So Meng mentioned co-design, and we haven't done that in terms of our immigration policy. So that's a first step for me. I think some of the values that Māori contribute to all of us, manaakitanga, for example, is something that ought to be involved in our broad immigration policy settings. And then I think there's always the implementation question. So sometimes we think about policy as being grand and vision and design, but it's actually what happens on the ground which is critically important. So which institutions, which communities, which people are going to lead that at the local level?
He's sitting right next to you right here. You can have a word with him, I think. Arama, what do you think a Tiriti-led immigration policy would look like?
Well, I think we need to give full expression to Te Tiriti of Waitangi. That means tinoranga tiratanga. So in my view, we need Māori independence. So with our political independence, it won't be just a case of co-design, but rather shared decision-making moving into the future.
Minister, what considerations are you giving to the Tiriti in this review?
Oh, look, it's not just immigration. I think if we think about how we look after people who arrive, I think education plays a big part. Employment plays a big part, and I don't mean employment of the migrants, but also looking after New Zealanders. And again, I'll stress the point of Māori and Pacifica who have had generational challenge there. And I think, you know, taking a first step of teaching our own history in schools, and that being and those who are coming to New Zealand, and those kids who are coming to New Zealand being exposed to that is really important. But then again, I think it can express itself in the likes of the regional school leadership group, where we have included iwi in those groups. Because it is important for when we talk about skills and employment and immigration in a region, that the local iwi are a part of that as well.
I was speaking about it with Meng Foon earlier. Of course, when refugees are resettled in New Zealand, they're assisted through that process. They go to a resettlement centre and they learn a little bit about New Zealand society and New Zealand culture. There are no such requirements for new migrants to New Zealand. Should that change?
Oh, look, I think we can always do a better job of landing migrants into New Zealand. There is quite an intensive package of support that goes around refugees, and that is the right thing to do. I think it's not just a government responsibility here. It's about how education is set up to acknowledge that there might need to be some what I would call cultural literacy in classrooms, so that they understand that when children turn up in a classroom, their norms are not the norms of New Zealand, and they understand how they behave differently, which might seem a challenge in the classroom, but they are not. It's just how they have come to a different setting. And also businesses and employers who might bring them in have to make sure that they are helping them integrate as well.
I want to ask about businesses and employers' roles and responsibilities in a moment, but I'm really interested in that point. Does anyone else have strong thoughts as to whether or not new migrants in New Zealand should be subjected to some sort of cultural education?
Useful. I sometimes used to... I mean, I know refugees are fleeing war-torn countries and conflict, so, you know, they deserve to have the chance to come here, but I always admired that they had a place where they could learn about New Zealand. And I think for immigrants, that would have been so useful, because you have to kind of figure it out as the years go by. And sometimes you learn the hard way.
We had a program at Massey University in which the local migrant communities, largely Asian, were welcomed onto the campus by tangata whenua as part of matariki. And that was a hugely successful learning exercise for both communities. And I don't think we have enough opportunities for that sort of exchange to take place. I would not want cultural literacy to be a criteria for deciding who should come, but we as a community have a responsibility to increase that cultural literacy.
Well, under the moment, at the moment, of course, skilled migrant, under the skilled migrant worker, you get a certain number of points for English proficiency, don't you? But you wouldn't want to see that be a requirement, but rather an option for education for migrants.
Well, I think the Minister made a good point before, Jack, was that actually a lot of New Zealanders don't know our history either. You know, they've they've learnt things through osmosis, and have obviously learnt the culture of being a New Zealander through osmosis. But the ignorance of what's gone on in New Zealand over the last 200 years and well, you know, last 800 years, if you like, is very strong. And so, you know, I think we need to do this for everyone, not just for migrants. All right.